Welcome to Verbal Pick Radio, where we give you a verbal image of life, and we are everyday people. I got my co-host, man, the host in the building. You know, love to have him on because his intake and insight on situations, and we go in a little deep, delving into the metaphysics, the science, visualizing, but actually not just visualizing, but bringing things into reality and showing the evidence that what we say can be done. This is not wishful thinking. So who better to have on the part three of the movie Black Panther as we bring in concepts into reality other than Krishna on the show live and direct? What's up, Brother Krishna?
What's going on, Brother Black, with the grandiose intro?
Hey, man.
Hey,
I'm humble. Hey, man, real with it. Is that what it is, man? I mean, I be having folks, man, you know, that I talk to, they say, yeah, man, that young brother, man, be dropping science, you know. I'm like, that's true indeed. And before we get started, gotta give a shout out to man Johnson the Cook, man, who be checking out the show, bro. Celebrity cook in H-Town, man. Cook from everybody from Rick Ross to whatever, man. You know what I mean? Rockets and whoever, man. So that's what's up, man. But we getting started on the movie Black Panther, and we're gonna just kick around some ideas and thoughts and put these thoughts in the universe so it can come back to us and create this reality on, can we create a Wakanda? I'm saying it right, Wakanda?
Mm-hmm. Wakanda.
Wakanda. Can we create that, and do we have to start with the mind first of visualizing it within the mind first so it can come into existence, and can we have that mind, peaceful mindset, being up under a rule such as the colonizer, like the young lady said in the movie? What do you think? Can we get ourselves into that frame of thought and deal with this colonizer at the same time? Or, like Killmonger said, do we have to go out and remove the colonizer and then come up?
Well, I don't think we have to look any further than what's already in existence. You know, you have nations like China where on the chess game that they're playing, they're not attacking Europeans in a physical sense. They're playing a mental game. So they're moving their chess pieces around, taking over territories, grabbing up resources, doing trade, building up their army, building up their technology. And, I mean, it's as simple as that. You know, that's the times that we're in. I mean, you do still have, you know, instances with, let's just use the Europeans as an example, as one example of where they're still, you know, playing this game of chess in a savage kind of way, you know, in a beast-like kind of way, you know, instead of approaching it from a mental aspect, you know, playing a game of international politics, you know, they're still engaging in barbaric, you know, so to speak, or, you know, savage ways of taking over, you know, pieces of land for resources.
So, but in the most sense, it sounds like that We created a boogeyman, or he's a boogeyman now. We giving him life. Are we giving him more credit than he deserves?
In most instances, yes. In most instances, yes, because, you know, our greatest competition is always the person in the mirror. So ain't nobody stopping us but us. And if you're listening to this, ain't nobody stopping you but you, mm-hmm. but yourself. As long as you're an adult. Now, if you're a child, then, you know, you would have to, you know, we have to look at the guardians in terms of where the responsibility lies. But if you're an adult, then you got to take your destiny in your own hands and make the right choices to align with that balance, that middle path, that narrow path.
Okay. Now we get into, does your environment shape your thinking? And dealing with the movie, because you had The king with T'Challa.
Mm-hmm.
He's in living and grew up in Wakanda.
Right.
You got Killmonger per se, had him growing up in the hood.
In Oakland.
Yep. In Oakland, in the hood, right?
Right.
Now, does that shape the concept of thinking, because they had two different frames of thought? under the oppression, I guess, that Killmonger was up under, turned him into, or turned his mind into that thinking process that, hey, man, it's rough out here, man, it's aggressive, you got to go get it, take these people out the way, and create your own peace. But the other guy, I guess he, in a sense, that euphoric, he got waterfowl, man, he in nature, he hearing birds singing, rally disruptive, and felt as though he can trust the CIA agency to even bring him up into his homeland, being oblivious to the fact that, hey, he would come in and snatch everything you got, but you trying to offer your best. You trying to do, like you wrote in the thing, humanity and mankind. You trying to show a humanitarian effort, but you don't know, man, that this beast is getting ready to bite you. But the dude in the hood knew, say, man, these folk bite, and they couldn't correlate the message between each other.
Right. 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 I mean, it's, you know, I think that, you know, this mentality, you know, that happens with people comes from a lack of understanding. You know, early in Knowledge Itself, you know, one of the things that I wanted to know the origins of certain people. And once I went and I did a lot of research, got a lot of books and a lot of references, listened to a lot of, you know, teachers that I respected because they provided a lot of books and a lot of references to cross-reference things, different perspectives, is, and then add that on to my own personal experience I've had all my life, I've been able to identify where certain people or certain groups, where they fall into play when it comes into this whole game of life, this whole matrix, this whole, you know, Maya, this Malkuth, this game that we're in.
Enlightenment, bro, enlightenment.
So once you know that, then you know where to properly place people, you know, okay. And that's when I stopped taking things so personally, because when you have something in existence, when its function is to put pressure on the coal to make the diamond, then how you gonna get mad at the dog for biting a motherfucking ass when that's what it was bred for? You know, you breed a, when I seen that pit bull across the street, man, grab onto that dog through the fence, grabbed onto the other dog through the, just getting too close to the house, had his whole neck. It took the owner, you know, my neighbor Sharon, you know, in order to come and tell the dog to release it. So you can't get mad at the dog behind the fence that grabbed the neck. I was just cutting my neighbor. But the point is that, you know, it's just doing what it was created to do. So yeah, it ain't personal.
Right.
It's just business as usual,
right,
for the function of that particular entity.
Right. Everybody, you know, doing their job.
Yeah. And so if we don't let our emotions get us out of our game, then, you know, we can have a Floyd Mayweather type performance.
Come on, bro.
You know?
That's true. Now, on that note, then, okay, on the emotion part, though, did that come from, as they say, and doing study, that at one point the female was revered and was the leader in certain tribes, even the female warriors and whatnot. You think that we had to adapt in this new system to where we had to be overly aggressive, or the emotional part, or by the females ruling at one time, that they ruled out emotions? Or are you saying that there should be no emotions and rule just based on mathematics and science and what is, and take all the emotions out of the picture? You know, and the reason why I ask this question is because I believe, and I could be wrong, but I do believe that we did have a pre-civilization where it was like a Wakanda, where there was a peaceful atmosphere and didn't nobody aggress upon any other. But if it did, we handled it, and then we went on. You know what I mean? But the most part was to study, build, and grow. Now, being like, as we stated earlier in the show, being up under this type of ruler turned us into a person, you write, that had to be on the defense all the time. You know what I mean? So getting back to that original place, that original mindset, do we have to be more sympathetic towards one another. Because, you know, for especially brothers, man, being sympathetic towards one another is like, you know, everybody got to put the hard face on, bro. And we can't get past that to where, man, look, man, okay, man, we had a problem, man. Okay, look here, bro, I tell you what. It's just like in the game, I would say, damn, dude, you going to take him out over this little old money. Why don't you just let him work it out? You know what I mean? Right. This man got a family and kids. It ain't, what the hell, dude? You know, and we ain't even bring this shit in the hood in the first place. Right. You see what I'm saying? So can we find a place where we can let our guards down against one another, relax, or do we always got to be on edge, man? You bump into me, man, guns and knives come out.
We have to pick and choose our battles.
Okay.
We got to pick and choose our battles. There's a time and a place for everything.
Right.
You know, so, but one thing that works for me is, you know, I got to be in the game. You know, put me in the game, coach. And when I'm in there, I got to be aggressive, you know. And I know everybody is different. I think that whatever goals, you know, that we have, we definitely want to, be disciplined enough to do them consistently. But to your question, though, in terms of, you know, having to have that mean mug on and, because of the environment that we're in, I think that everybody just got to do what works for them.
Okay.
You know, I mean.
Only reason why I ask that is I'm thinking as far as, and we're going to get into the coach science and nature after this. But I'm thinking as far as, and I could be wrong, but I'm thinking if we project that positive energy within the universe, then the above so below, then what's under our feet start turning towards us. But I'm trying to see how do we get in the frame of mind to even throw the positive, but we are always like this, you know, pushing, pulling all the time. You know what I mean? Is it a timeout in the game? Wait, hold up, man, let's rethink the rules of the game, or... You know what I mean? To get to the point to where, because I'm thinking, look, if I'm throwing positive thoughts in the universe, which I am, and I know this brother throwing positive thoughts out into the universe to benefit us, people as a whole, and say you got other brothers, we throwing it out there, now let energy going in one space and time, it got to come back and rain down on us some good. You know what I mean?
Right.
I'm thinking.
Yeah, it's always going to be, you know, the move to have the mind vibrating on the highest frequency possible within, you know, based on how the individual is applying whatever they're engaging in. So now in terms of let's just even say politicking with people is that, you know, me, I may work best with politicking with a smaller number of people. Some people can handle a larger group of people, more dynamic personalities just in terms of the different type of personalities that they got to deal with. I might not have the patience or just, you know. So each player on the team has their area of expertise.
Come on, right? Yes, sir.
You know,
yes,
sir. So, but the ultimate goal is for the team as a whole to be able to function to get the win.
Okay.
So, you know, so even when it comes to that starting five, it's important.
Yeah, you know.
But you know, you need a strong bench. You know, you're 6'7", 8". You know, you need that strong too. Yeah, you know, yeah. So, you know, we pick and choose our battles, and you know, in terms of you know, putting that high vibratory energy out there. You know, like I said, that's always the best move. And even with me, if I'm mean mugging, you know, based on somebody's perspective, it could, for me, in my mind, you know, I'm like, well, this is just my steel face. This is my thinking. You know, this is face, just my right, game face.
Right, right.
But it's not, but I don't have any ill intent towards anybody. It may just, you know, just because, you know, I have the kind of spirit that I do. You know, I'm an Aquarius, you know, I'm a loner, you know, I've always, you know, never really ran with a huge amount of people.
Right.
You know, it's just me recognizing who I am and embracing that and maximizing the potential of the type of spirit that I am, the type of soul that I am.
I'm glad you said that, because that clarifies a lot of things. Because whether you in Houston or New York, Chicago, wherever, Cleveland, whatever, you have those type of personalities amongst us as a people that flows through. So whenever y'all out and y'all see somebody that's in deep thought, don't take it as this dude or get offended as though you being checked, or don't be so quick to like, mean, but what's up? You know what I mean? It's on, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Cat just thinking because it's on, you know what I mean? That right. Quick, so just right. think outside the box. And you know that could be wisdom channeling, man, through this universe, and you taking it the wrong way,
right?
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Because right. So on the occult science and nature, and we know a thought or the soul or soul of man, or that's SOL sun. Or that penetrates through that soil, or that soul that produces or germinates that seed, and it comes forth into the light and produces good substance for us, whether it's an orange or, you know, pear, whatever, we can feed off of that. Well, also so does our thoughts, as is in that darkness, or that melanated, that space in the mind, or that kundalini energy, or however you call. Okay, we give it. Hold on. I'm coming back to that. Let me ask you this though, bro. Chakra. Somebody say, man, we shouldn't use the word chakra.
Who said that?
Okay, cool. yeah, that it didn't represent. I don't know.
Man, please.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, right, please. Right. You know, I mean,
I can't remember who said it, but okay.
Man, it's got so many different names. I mean, chakra is not, that's not a term where, you know, some type of colonizer or something, you know, use that as, you know, for ill intent against our people. So, I mean, okay. why wouldn't we use the term?
Okay, why wouldn't? So then that chakra that you don't see, it's in that dark space as well, but it that electricity, it illuminates out forward, whether it's your heart chakra or whatnot. You feel that energy, or sometimes when them chakras align, that energy vibration is... You in tune with this universe because the planet has a heartbeat.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we use the co-science and tie nature all in together? Because the thing is, we want to recreate or create or even get to, and we just using Wakanda as an example. But how do we tie all that to help get us on the path to achieve said goal?
Right. Okay, so... what I took from it, you know, and just on this, just within this conversation about what you're speaking on, taking nature and combining it with technology, well, even in this city, you know, represents a form of balance to a certain degree, even though it is under jurisdiction, it is Houston DBA, we know that, doing business as. At the same time, we can look at it as where you see, you know, some level of technology with a certain amount of nature going on, you know, so you could ride through the city and you could see what looks like little mini forests, you know, all over the city. And, you know, that's a necessity because, you know, really when it comes to this concrete as a whole is really considered debris. That's why nature's always fighting against it, trying to get penetrated, you know, because it's not working in conjunction with nature. You know, it's so nature is, I may have a vine outside of my home and then it in some kind of way done broke through the breaker panel and then got inside of the house. It's a vine because, you know, and that comes with insects and everything else. It's nature, you know, and debris don't get along, you know. So, you know, us taking what we know about nature, gardening, cultivating the land, you know, having lakes, you know, and utilizing airspace to our advantage, and combining that with something which we're not going to give up in America, which is technology. You know, we're going to keep, you know, our smartphones and the internet and things. Well, you know, we're not going to be, you know, silly about this in terms of, you know, how many, you know, of our people are really willing to give that up and just live, you know, just strictly, you know, by nature. Now, I'm not saying that some will do that. But those same people, I see them out in nature and they got a cell phone in front of their face broadcasting on YouTube talking about, you know, my name is nature such and such. You know, no pun intended. But I'm just saying, you know, so, you know, with, I was listening to KT Art's degree and he was breaking down vibranium and it just, to me, you know, it was such high level information and knowledge in terms of, you know, the level of genius that our people have when it comes to technology and utilizing nature and metals and alloys in order to create, you know, different things or put, you know, natural things together, you know, to solve problems. You know, so Wakanda was a great example of how to take nature and how to take spirit. You know, they spoke a lot on the ancestors. You know, they had, you know, the deity aspect with the cat deity. I think it was Bast, you know, which is Sekhmet and Kemet. You know, even the Catholic, you know, religion is, you know, based on the worship of the cat. You know, that's why the root of it is cat. You know, Catholicism is still the worship of that. If you go into the Gnostic Bible, then you'll see Yahweh associated with the cat. You know, so when you combine, you know, the spiritual aspect and nature with everything that, since we, you know, created, you know, all of these inventions anyway, you know, it was red pill, if I'm not mistaken, I'm pretty sure it was on the Black Magic 363 channel showing up the list of a thousand inventions that our ancestors created. So when it comes to technology and the things that we could do and the level that we could take it to, combined with spirituality and nature, then we could create, you know, it's already being done to a certain extent, but I think Wakanda showed a great example of the level that we could take it to when we don't have a lot of, you know, perpetrators, infiltrators, people trying to drop cocaine into our neighborhoods, you know, people, you know, that are looking to disrupt, you know, what we have going on because they feel like they're in competition with us while we, on our highest level, are only looking at ourselves as the next level to achieve.
Right. Before we end, the technology of the hologram, right, that they you would see them holding their hand and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Can that be similar to where you can see a person, where you can communicate, whether it be your ancestor spirit or you can see the God inside an individual, that spirit, that hologram, because the hologram represents a spirit. You know what I mean? Even though it was, you could see the picture in the form, but the essence of that energy, that we would have the power to go inside of ourselves to communicate or talk to the ancestors or that seed or that genetic coding that we are part of through our lineage, and pull out the information and knowledge that they may have had or tried to pass on to share with us in today's time.
Mm-hmm.
In a sense.
Yeah. You can get the book Psychic Vampires by Dr. Joe A. Slate. I believe that's the author's full name. And they have in there a part in the book where they talk about technology that has already been utilized and they use it around the thumb. And from the thumb, they can make a determination on the aura. You know, then they get into actual techniques and practices that you can get into in order to be able to see, you know, people's auras. You know, and that book is, you know, it's a great book just to get your hands on anyway. So this technology already exists. As well, you know, check out Brother Panic and get your hands on the book Cyclomancy, where that book is a detailed book where it'll teach you how to increase your five senses through exercises, you know, actual exercises where you sit down and you start, you know, working on being able to send signals from your mind to different parts of your body to do what you needed to do. So if you can move your toes on one foot and you can't move it the same way on your other foot, you have all the muscles and everything to make that accomplish. You just may not have worked out that part of the mind to send the signal there. You know, so even when it comes to moving your ears without touching them, you know, just different parts of your body, you have, your body is able, is capable of doing a lot of things, but you got to exercise, just like muscle memory, in order to have that signal sent from your mind to those parts of bodies to be able to utilize it. So that book is great for your senses, your eyes, your taste, etc. And there will be an effect will also occur when it comes to whenever you go into the dream state, when you're in a dream and, you know, you may not have a sense of smell in there. Well, if you work on cultivating your sense of smell, utilizing a book like Cyclomancy, then you will see that sense of smell kick in when you're in the dream realm, because everybody doesn't they don't experience the same senses when they're in the dream realm. You know, some people, you know, they don't taste. Some people may not hear as well. You know, so, you know, the book, you can get the book Astrodynamics and Astral Travel by Astrodynamics by Robert Bruce, if I'm not mistaken, the white book, and Astral Travel by Yvonne and Gavin Frost. And they'll go into detail on you, how your senses and how people, some people use different senses in their dream, but everybody doesn't necessarily use all five of their senses because of, I'll give you a personal example. You know, and I know we're about to wrap this up.
No, go, bro. I'm like, yeah.
I don't have necessarily the best sense of smell. You know, now that may have something to do with, you know, I need to clear some path, you know, get into some Dr. Eileen breathing techniques and clear some things out in the body. When I go into the dream state, I don't never smell anything. I don't never come out the dream and say, I smelled this, I smelled that. So there's a direct connection between what's happening in my conscious state when I'm walking around talking and smelling, and my subconscious state when I'm in the, which is the dream state, where there is a lack of that particular sense. So this is something, you know, that people can do to get into some of these super senses that we have access to.
That for one, as we travel on this planet, man, moving at the terrific speed of 1,037 and third miles per hour, right? The knowledge that came forth on this travel is once in a lifetime, right? Y'all got to share this one, you know, with your friends and your families in the post, because brother dug deep, man. And I mean, I'm sitting over here learning. Man, the white book, I got to get it, bro. I mean, you know, and look, man, to Dr. Eileen Bay and Brother Panic and Red Pill, Blue Pill, and those out there, you know, when you can tell the effect that your work has on people who will come back and look and use you as a reliable source that went in and studied your work. When if Brother Krishna say it's gold, bro. You see what I'm saying? If he say y'all work is gold, it's gold, and then you would get other people in this town from different hoods, man, that'll give y'all a listen to, bro. Because you've been verified by somebody word who always been gold. So, yeah, y'all got to give him much, much love. You know what I mean? Trust me. As this circulates, bro, believe that. So, yeah, man, hey, always, bruh, yeah, you know what I mean? Drop that science because it's a universal. She got to understand one thing about Houston, man.
Mm-hmm.
When you travel through the city, you got every denomination damn near on the planet in each time.
Mm-hmm.
In the different parts of the city, you know, right, you can travel through, right?
Right.
But the difference is we have more warm or more tropical or more sun days.
Right.
So we shining damn near 365 days a year.
Right, grinding and shining.
We grinding and shining.
Yeah.
So that means then that when we spread your works amongst the city, or when Houston catch hold and spreads it, that's the globe.
Right. Right.
Because everybody leaving, they start going back to their homeland, a country where they from, whatever, they come back. Uh-huh. Not, but we bask, but we in the sun.
Right.
You know what I mean? And no disrespect to up on East Coast, whatever, but I mean, they get winters, man. It'd be cold in the winter. And I say that to say, because in some of us that was, especially on the East Coast, that was brought here out of tropical climates to New York, didn't ask your family actually come here. That part of slavery. And then to the native that might have migrated, who chose, who already been over here. But I said to say that when they were in Europe, and them cold, rainy every day, and they rarely seen the sun. And when the Moors traveled and they could see the sun in the people, they knew they had to come from somewhere better than where they was at.
Right.
That melanin is soaking up them sun rays, and then it not vibrates, but it sends back that energy to where you can see it. It's vibrant. You can see, you damn near can look at a, especially if eating healthy and the sunshine, you can see the sun in humans.
Right.
And that being.
Right.
So they got jealous right off the bat. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I'm just saying, and I say this to say that, you know, don't be so quick. Because we in the country. We love the country. This nature. Mm-hmm. This weather. This travel. So don't be so quick to this. Regard knowledge if it didn't come out the East Coast, I guess is what I'm saying.
Right.
You know what I mean? But right. but a shout out to those who had that those movements, man. You know, the Moorish movement was strong from Philly to New York.
Right.
RBG's is strong.
Right.
And we take that and regurgitate it up under the sun, bro. We come together. Mindsets, man. I guess what I'm saying is throw that mind energy for your brothers down here in South as we throw that mind energy for the brothers up there, man, on the East and up on the North, and then build this Wakanda, man.
That's right, man. OG Bobby Hemmings is from the South. You know?
Yeah,
from the South, so hey.
That's science, bro.
Hey, man. And you know, that's Brother Panic's mentor. So there you go.
Oh, man, that's a connection, bro.
That's a connection, come man. On. He was on Dr. Aleem to teach, you know. And look how cold that brother is,
that
you know, master teacher.
Cold. That brother is cold, bro. But, hey, that's the science. Verbal Pick Radio. Make sure you spread it. Subscribe. This is one for the ages. And if you haven't seen the movie Black Panther, go check it out. Verbal Pick Radio, we out.
Yay, yay.